feel this way. I feel like it's a function of being able to risk tolerance. You don't know what brings you in. How many of you would say you have a pretty high risk tolerance? You're willing to take risks. Okay. And then I have a related question. How many of you feel like you need a level of control in your day-to-day life, when you go to work? Okay. So I thought what I would do is a little bit different than, again, sort of what the description was. I thought I would give you kind of my own background and my own bio, talk about policy work and talk about what that looks like, you know, how you go about searching for jobs and that kind of thing. And then what I kind of wanted to do was reserve a little bit of time at the end to talk about failure, because that's something that I wish that somebody had talked to me about whenever I was y'all's age, and it happens all the time. That's where those risk tolerance and control questions were coming from, because I have a very low tolerance for risk, and I have a very high need for control, but you can't really succeed all the time. Okay, so let me tell you all a little bit about myself so that you all have a sense of who I am and why I'm talking about all this. So I'm originally from the Rio Grande Valley. I grew up there. I went away for college, for undergraduate. I went to Dartmouth College for undergraduate. And then I went abroad. I was in college. I wound up being a German major after a few tries at other majors. Worked when I was there in various roles in internships, including for some of the senators here. I had an internship that my school helped me for with Parliament, the Ukraine Parliament, kind of a cool experience. And then after finishing my undergraduate, I went abroad to the United Kingdom. I got a master's degree there from the University of Essex in political science, which was a phenomenal experience. I came back, I kind of messed around a little bit. I wasn't really sure what I was going to be doing. I eventually found a job working in the legislature, which is something I absolutely recommend. I'm going to talk about that in a minute for everybody who is even slightly interested. I worked in the legislature. I worked a little bit in D.C. for a think tank based there. I spent a little more time in the U.K. And then I decided I really wanted to build on my skills, and I also never wanted to be put in a position again where I couldn't find a job. So I decided to go back to graduate school, and that's when I came here to UT. I did a dual degree here, and I did a master's of public affairs over here at the LJ School, and I did a JD degree over here at the law school, so that took about 4 years. And I found a lot of fun. I mean, not all of it was fun, some of it was fun, but some of it was really enjoyable. And I also worked throughout my time, for the most part, most of the semesters. I don't know if this is applicable to any of you all, but I worked for most of the semesters in a huge variety of places. I mean, I worked 3 regular sessions of the legislature, worked for several state agencies, including the Department of Information Resources. I got some really boring jobs. Like, that's part of this. But I got some really kind of interesting and exciting jobs, too. Where else did I was a research assistant for one of my professors here. That was honestly a really great thing. And one of the things that I learned about and I explored while I was here, which I never had explored to before, was higher education policy. And it turned out that this was what I wanted. I tried really hard to, you know, be a lawyer and be a practicing lawyer. I thought that was what I came to school to do, but I also realized it didn't scratch a lot of the itches that I had. So in my last year here, one of the other things that I did was in Texas, state agencies and university systems are led by boards of regents or kind of boards of directors. There's a way to be appointed as a non-voting student member on for the UT Board of Regents, and there's also one for the state agency. So I did that in my final year, and that was a very fascinating experience. I had a wonderful time my last year. I had a lot of time. I spent a lot of that time networking, which I'm going to tell you about in a second, momentarily. And I wound up working for an education nonprofit while I was studying for the bar. The bar was unpleasant, but the education nonprofit was one of the best jobs I ever had. And after that, I worked for a university in my hometown area called University of Texas, Rio Grande Valley. And what I did there was academic policy work. So they launched something like a dozen new degree programs, so new PhDs, new doctorate programs, new master's programs, new bachelor's programs. I was one of the people who helped review and send those away to the people who would approve it eventually. And I also did a lot of other stuff that was way more boring than that. That was probably kind of like the headline of my time there. So I was there for about a year and a half, and the professor who I worked for in law school, in graduate school, was named the Commissioner of Higher Education. So there's one person who's named by sort of the board of directors of the agency that governs higher ed, who is the Commissioner of Higher Education, which is a little bit like the Commissioner of Education, but like, not as powerful, perhaps, is what I would say. You won't repeat this to him, but like, I think that's what I would basically say. So, but he was named that, which meant that he led the agency responsible for higher education, and he gave me a call and wanted to see if I might be interested in coming back up. So I came back up right in the middle of the pandemic in 2020, in May 2020. That's kind of where I've been. I'm now policy counsel with the agency, and so a lot of what I do now is essentially rule writing, but I've also had a chance to work on a lot more interesting things. Like we have a statewide strategic plan for higher education, so I got to do a lot of big policy kind of research on that. I also, I'm going to speak more about in a minute, completely helped rewrite our rules for approving new programs, which was what I did when I was at the university, and also for distance education. So that brings us to here. That's kind of my bio so that you have a sense of where I'm coming from and what my experiences were like. So I'm going to move into talking a little bit about what policy work is like, what it means to do policy work. Policy work is you decide what things should be, and then you make it so. It requires a lot of different tools to figure out what should be. Sometimes it's being able to understand patterns of data, like why are students moving the way they're moving through the system? You know, why are students dropping out at this one point? Are they prepared in the courses that they're taking, the math courses that they're taking at X, Y, Z point, and how are you seeing that in outcomes? So that's kind of a type of policy analysis. I also do a lot more researching and writing, just kind of generally, as I mentioned, I help rewrite our distance education rules. So if any of you take a fully online course here, if you've ever done that, those rules that are statewide for all public institutions, those are the ones that we helped rewrite, and that was honestly really fun. So my favorite part of policy making is when you can bring a group of people who would not be in the same room together, or sometimes kind of like looking at each other, and you can get them to agree on something and build something cool. So what that entailed was there was a group of faculty members, and they came together, they decided how they wanted to revise these definitions, and basically I provided kind of technical expertise to say, okay, here's how we write rules, and this is what it looks like in practice. And then more generally, so that's what my day looks like. It's a super varied field. I mean, I don't know if any of you all have talked to anybody in policy, but it's everything from, you know, like energy policy, national security, health policy. I mean, you could do transportation. I'm not on fire about transportation, but I know some people who super are. You know, like that's, you can do a whole lot of different things essentially with it. And you can have days where all you do is interact with people. You can have days where all you do is kind of sit in a back room and type away at a computer, which for some reason is what I found myself doing lately, otherwise I like the interaction with people. So where is there policy work? Of course, DC is the obvious answer. I have spent some time there. I like a lot better here. I have a lot more fun in Austin. It's just, it's a more fun place to work in some ways, in my opinion. Of course, the obvious, the state legislature, state government, I can speak pretty extensively on that. But also, you know, the nonprofit industry, I worked for a nonprofit, and that's a very different experience. So for one thing, when you work in the public sector, anybody can request to see any of your emails. And if you're in a nonprofit or you're in a private institution, you don't have to worry about that so much. That was really kind of liberating. It was a great experience. It was very small, it was pretty nimble. You did a lot of different things. And there's some people who've gone into the private sector, working in consulting. So So you can find, I've worked in a lot of like really big, cumbersome, horrible bureaucracy, but you can also find little bitty nimble sort of offices if that's more what you're interested in. A legislative office typically has about six people in it, and you are responsible for an amazing amount of sort of breadth of material and knowledge, and it's up to you to kind of advise your member on whether or not to vote for something, or it's up to you to bring people together to negotiate like a bill on a particular issue. I mean, that stuff is kind of cool. A little bit underpaid, but honestly super awesome. But so that's a little bit about policy as well. So I wanted to move into how do you go about searching for policy jobs, if that's something that you all are interested in. And I also kind of want to speak more broadly about what I found works for job searches. So the kind of like the standard way of doing it, like hitting the hammer, you know, on the nail kind of thing, is find a bunch of job openings and applying for those. And obviously there's LinkedIn. There's a few other specific websites, things like Working Texas, Christine's List is subscription, they have some good stuff. Texas Political Jobs, they have a bunch of good stuff on there. That's one way to do it. I'm not crazy about it, but I feel like it's low percentage, but that's definitely a way to do it. Interning is also a pretty nice way to get you put in the door, and there are more paid internships now than there used to be. Sometimes there are pockets of support as well. I don't know what that looks like here. When I was an undergraduate, I was able to support interning in the British Parliament with the stipend that my university had paid. I don't know if that's, I think that there probably are opportunities like that kind of floating around generally. But there are a lot more paid internships. The likelihood it's paid increases disproportionately to like the glamorousness of the job. So sometimes that is something to look for. But my favorite way to get into a job, like one of my favorite activities period, is networking. I love networking. Like some people love dating. I hate dating, but I love networking. I love it. So I've gone through a bunch of job searches, and I feel like I've kind of been honing my technique and what it is that I do whenever I go and I want to network with somebody. So in terms of starting, when I was at UT, what I did was I started with my professors. I also started with some colleagues because I had been, you know, interning or working. Like I had some colleagues who I could ask for assistance and ask them to kind of open up their Rolodex. Those are good places. There's, you know, you could cold email people, cold message people on LinkedIn. In fact, I'm just about to do that. Probably tomorrow I need to do that. And it actually, you know, if you write it the right way, people will get hooked. You go to events and you just talk to them. And I love people. And they're all doing something kind of interesting. And they all have weird things that they're kind of hung up about, or they have trends that are happening within their company, or there's trends that they see in an industry that you know nothing about. I remember having a conversation with somebody about ERCOT, like 5 years before the grid fail. Like I don't know if you had heard of ERCOT before that happened. And I talked to somebody who was very passionate about it, and I'd never heard of it. That was kind of useful information. And then what I suggest, or at least what I like to do, is I like to track as I go. I like to mark, you know, the people who I reach out to, how I find them, leads that come out of, like I said, I really love control. Like we did the question at the very beginning, which is me like being very obsessive and controlling about. But I talk about, you know, I try to record job opportunities that come out of it, and I record in the spreadsheet whether or not I didn't make you notes at the end, like whether or not I remembered to send them an email thanking them for their time. But the most important thing is, there's in qualitative research, they call this snowball technique, where you talk to one person and then they recommend another three people and then they recommend another three people. And that's just the way to do it. And that's also part of what I track in my spreadsheet. So relationships are life. I love them. And everybody's kind of interesting. Even the people who aren't that interesting, they have something that, you know, everybody has like something that they're kind of in conflict over or something that they love. And that stuff is awesome. It's really awesome to get to talk to them and see what it is. And another thing, searching more generally, moving away from networking, is if you are looking in the public sector, don't forget that salaries are searchable in public. I have never had a job where you could Google any and just like find out how much I make. So keep that in mind, and that's a helpful thing for like being able to negotiate a little bit down the line. And the other thing I want to mention, because I didn't know this until later, and it was a very good lesson to learn, and it is a little bit industry dependent. I would say approach job searching and approach networking from an abundance mindset and not from a scarcity mindset. In other words, there's, depending on the industry, a lot of different things out there that might be open for you. And there's some things that are the right fit, and there's some things that just kind of aren't the right fit. There's some things that are the right fit, and you submit an application, and then you never hear back from them again. They just like drop off the leader. But if you go in thinking, this is abundant, like there's a lot of different opportunities out there, there's a lot of different ways that I could fit in or not fit in. I think this applies to other areas too, but I have trouble like practicing it as much as with job searching. I know that I am somebody of worth, and I have skills that could be useful in a variety of contexts, and it completely changes the way that I approach networking and the fear that I felt, or like the rejection and the unhappiness that I used to feel. But this is my suggestion for you all, because there's a lot of stuff out there. It may not be the right fit for you, or maybe the right fit. I don't know. So, okay. The last thing I wanted to talk about was, as I mentioned at the beginning, I was thinking about failure a whole lot lately. I've been listening to a bunch of podcasts about it. I'm trying to figure out how to navigate it. You know, how do you come through the other side? How do you deal with it? Because it feels terrible in the moment. So I wanted to maybe tell you all a little story about how I sort of navigated coming into life out of college with an emphasis on kind of the failure, the feelings of failure that I felt. And then sort of discuss types of failure and how you can choose to react to failure or come out of failure. So I gave you all my bio at the beginning, but then I kind of skipped over, I didn't go into great detail for some of the stuff that was maybe kind of painful or tricky at the time or didn't work very well. So when I was in college, I really struggled. I did not do super well, frankly. I might have no sleeping issue, and so essentially like my days would become nights, and I would sleep for like 20 hours, and then I would stay awake for 24 hours. Anyway, as you might imagine, this like really wreaked havoc with my grades and my social life and with my eating habits, and I just kind of found myself living in a little dark cave in this gross off-campus house, and there would be like snow up to here, and that was just kind of like what my world narrowed down to. I felt awful. I constantly felt like a failure. I remember it really vividly. Like, I just thought, what am I doing? This is not a real life. And look at all these other people who were in school with me, and they kind of have their stuff together. Not all of them, some of them. Or at least they're not as miserable as I am. Or they don't seem like they're as miserable as I am. Anyway, and I was trained at all these majors. You know, I was an English major, and then I was a government major, and then I was a German major for whatever reason, and that wasn't the one that stuck. So I graduated as a German major. And I remember I had a really complicated degree plan. And the week before my graduation, my whole family's coming up. I get a call from the department chair of the German department, and she's a scary lady. I took a seminar with her, there were six of us in it, and she made every single person cry in that class. She calls me up and she says, you have a problem with your degree plan. You are not on track to graduate, basically. And I am miserable. It turns out my degree plan was so complicated, and I took so many German classes because almost none of the first ones counted for my major because it was introductory, that there was a wrinkle that happened, and so a week before graduation, she informed me that I might not be graduating. My whole family's coming. I cannot wait to get out of this place. in preparation for graduation, this is a little bit of a maybe gross detail. I go and get my eyebrows waxed, and the stress freaks me out so much that I have a little unibrow that's going right across my face. It was gross. I was stressed, man. But like a few days later, she calls Amp and she says, you know, we figured out a different degree plan, and you are going to be able to graduate with this. And I was like, okay, good, because I am not coming back to this place. I'm done. So I had a kind of miserable time in college. And then I went through this master's program, which was phenomenal. Like, that was the only year of my life where I ever had my sleep under control. And from that, everything else flowed. Like, my eating habits were great. I had some amazing friends. I loved the material that I was learning about. It was just, I left that program really wanting to have more coursework. Like, we did a lot of working with data and figuring out how to run like regression analyses. We did a lot of psychology and polling and learning how to design surveys and just some of the underlying political science. I love the whole thing. I love my professors. I just had an amazing time. So I come back and I'm hot stuff, right? And I go back to the valley. I'm like, I have this degree. I have you know, an undergraduate degree, and I have this incredible political science degree that has given me all of the remarkable skills. Anyway, turned out nobody was interested, nobody cared. And I did a lot of application and I got the one job that I was qualified to do with my degrees, which was the waitress in a German beer garden in my hometown, which was like, that was also, it's a tough job. I was not very good at it. I don't know if you've ever served or done anything like that before, but you know, on beer, you're supposed to have a pretty small head. And I feel like every time I poured, it would be like 3/4 of a head. Anyway, so I was really bad at my job. You know, and days are going by, and I just kind of want to keep pursuing this thing that I don't know what this passion for, but I'm in McAllen, Texas, and there's not any political science jobs, and people in D.C. were not that willing to, you know, take me on a flyer. Basically, like, I had the knowledge that I needed, and I was the person I needed to be, but I couldn't convince other people that that was true. So anyway, you know, the one thing about you get the German degree, you become the German beer garden waitress, and so one of the benefits was that there's a very, very, very small German diaspora of people who live in the valley, and they all came there. So we would, you know, I got to talking to some of the regulars in German very poorly, and it turned out that one of them was running what is called a maquiladora. I don't know how familiar you are with this. It's a kind of factory that has one site in the US and one site in Mexico, and people kind of go back and forth. And this was in 2012, so it was a little bit of a kind of a dicey time at that point. And he wanted me to do accounts receivable, and I was like, there's nothing wrong with accounts receivable, but I wanted to do policy work. I had a kind of a strange interview, and essentially, like, the long and short of it is, what would have happened is every morning I would have to get into an unmarked van with kind of the mirrors or the windows blacked out, and then we'd have a driver who would take us over to Rio Bravo, and then we'd get out, and that's where we'd do our work, and they'd take us back. Anyway, so my dad heard this, and I was living with my parents at the time, and he didn't have a real job, and he said, no. And I thought, I have no agency. I don't even want this job. I accepted this job, and now my dad is saying I can't do it. By the way, he was kind of right about it. But I just remember I downloaded that Rolling Stones song, You Can Always Get What You Want, and I'm just driving in my car and singing along. I'm like, you can't always get what you want. You know, like, I was at a little point. It was pretty pathetic. Anyway, so but I wound up getting a job at the legislature. So that was a good day, and that was a really fascinating job. But the long and short of it was, you know, I decided I never wanted to do that again. I came back to graduate school at UT, and I did have periods where things were kind of dry. I went through on-campus interviews, and I did it totally wrong. I didn't know what I was doing at all. I thought that the way that you do on-campus interviews is you say, hey, I could make a pitch to join this very specific, hyper-specific practice area of the firm. And that's just like not the way it works at all. You kind of say, okay, I like litigation, or I like transactional, and that's about it. That's as much. Anyway, I went through OCI, I struck out. I didn't get a single job offer out of the whole experience. But I also had that feeling of abundance rather than that feeling of scarcity, because by that point, I knew how to find a job. I knew how to talk about myself. I knew what my skills were. I knew that it was needed to be better. And it sucked. I mean, that was a failure too. I mean, it was a huge bummer at the time, because I thought, oh, I want to be an attorney, and then this one whole sector was closed off. But I also thought, well, probably in like a year or two, I'm gonna figure something out. Like, this may not work so bad. And that actually was true. Anyway, so those were at least some of the failures that I had. I've had many, many, many more than that. But I think I kind of wanted to sort of have a summation at the end. One of them is, regardless of your risk tolerance, some of you said I have a low risk tolerance. I know I always hang out with this, because I have a very low risk tolerance. And some of you say you have a high risk tolerance. Failure happens regardless of how much risk you're willing to stomach. Like, it will happen at some point. It just does. It's not something you want to court. It's not pleasant, but it just happens. And sometimes you go back and you look at it. So sometimes there are failures that are secretly successes with good reframing after the fact when you look at that. So the example that comes to mind, I don't know how many of you saw the basketball game last night or yesterday. And it was a super hard fought, you know, like he was ahead by about 10. And good for, you know, Miami, because they came up in like the last 5 or so minutes and they defeated it. But it made me wonder about the guys who were on the team, and it made me wonder, did they see it as a failure that they lost? Because they should be seeing it as an amazing success. I mean, you know, how often does your team get to go that far into the NCAA March Madness? I mean, how awesome did they play? I mean, they killed it, you know what I mean? So that to me is an example of something that might be like a reframing after the fact, and you have a little bit of time and you're like, oh, that was awesome. That was actually super cool. sometimes people will say you have to learn a lesson from every single failure. I'm here to tell you not every failure has like a super obvious lesson, or maybe has a lesson that you actually like have it anyway, but it still happens anyway. It's good to try to distill them. And then the last point I wanted to mention was failure. I think if you feel it deeply and you react in a constructive way, those are some of the most interesting people. You can choose how you want to react to failure. And I struggle with this all the time. I'm really bad at this. You can look at it and you can react with resilience and with coming through it, and perhaps you feel it deeply and it marks you. But that makes you kind of a wonderful person in the long run. And at least it's character building, which I hate, because who's gonna court failure? Like, don't go out and, you know, run into a wall or whatever, but, you know, like, it's, if you go through it with resilience and you feel it keenly, but you still come out at the other end, those people are really interesting and wonderful people. You'll find, I think, a little bit later. The other way that you can choose to react to failure, which I struggle constantly, is reacting with bitterness. I'm feeling it. I'm feeling it, not, you know, reacting with bitterness essentially right now. Like, I can think of all these situations where I think, oh my God, I hate that I didn't make a decision. So angry at those people, and this is just totally shut off a part of my life forever and ever, and it was because of their faults, or it was because of my fault, or whatever. I don't know.
Sorry. How was your experience studying like abroad in like the UK? Is it a lot different than?
It was very interesting. So the nature of the program was, okay, I think there were about like 80 to 100 people in it, and only, let's say, 3 of those people were British, and only 2 of them were American, and they were from pretty much every continent. Like, there were people from Taiwan, from Turkey, a lot of people from Mexico, from Spain, and they were all very interesting. There were a lot of small things that were different. Like, their semester, I had come from having a 9-week term system, which I hated. 0 out of 5 stars. Absolutely hated it. But they have extra long semesters. Like, it was, I want to say like a 4 or 5 month semester. Like, because you have to kind of like build out and develop the subject matter, and you have to like you know, study for midterms and then like barely get your breath and then study for finals and then switch to a different subject. And I really like being able to kind of school that out and learn a lot more about it. There were also some like funny features that were accidental. So I wanted to learn about British politics and European politics. So I signed up for their module on European politics. And it was taught by someone who I'm very fond of. He was this American with this very deep voice, and kind of looked a little bit like a boy band member from the 90s. Like, he had gel hair like this, and he was 5'2", and he's from New Jersey, and he wore a lot of cargo pants. Anyway, but everybody else in this class was like, why is this American teaching European politics? Like, who came here when it actually went European teaching, right? European politics. But so everybody except for two of us dropped out of class. And then the other guy was a huge flake, so he didn't show up like a third of the time anyway. So it was just like me in a one-on-one tutorial talking about the nature of the EU and how it's developed and the nature of democracies and how parties respond to voters. That was a big part of what we talked about. And I was like, it was pretty cool. I wanted more of it. The other thing is it's not a two-year program. It's like one full year, essentially, and then you do a dissertation at the end. So I was left really wanting more. I really wanted to develop what I had started when I was there. Very fun. Professor was real. He was the light.
I was gonna ask, you said you started as a legislative aide, but then I know more recently you've worked at agencies. Mm-hmm. Do you have a preference between like which policy world do you like better, or is there not much of a difference?
Agencies are paid a lot better, but the legislature is way more fun. Like, not even close. Way more fun. I mean, it just is a wildly unprofessional place. Like, they don't have an HR department really, but they kind of need one sometimes. But it's also just, you get to be really early in your career, and all of a sudden you're writing pieces of the Texas statutes, and like, really, like, you're slipping an amendment to your boss to put up on the floor, and you're working through a committee substitute, and it's really fascinating. And the people are very interesting, because you have all of these, you get very bored, kind of like with the very boring conflicts that we all know and are very familiar with, like left and right and that kind of thing. But sometimes you get conflicts between people that are kind of interesting or unusual, or people who would normally be on the same side. And that's one of my favorite things. And you can't really see that anymore with the legislature. So that's, and yeah, the people are very funny. Some of them are very strange. I love them very deeply. So that's my conclusion. But agency life is really pretty stable. And it is better paid, a lot better paid. You don't have to think about poverty to go into policy work. I mean, really, you can, I mean, you're probably not going to make like as much as you might in the private sector, perhaps, but it's, you know, not that poorly paid, honestly. Pretty good benefits, like, really good work life balance. So, really good.
So, my major is actually international relations and global studies, so I've always wanted to go into like international and foreign policy.
Yeah.
I'm only a freshman though, so how do you recommend like taking your choice?
This answer, I think, is gonna, like, you're gonna, I was not an undergrad at UT, is essentially mm-hmm. what I'm gonna say, and so I get the feeling that probably UT has programs and ways of navigating things that I don't fully know myself. But at least in my case, what I did was we had a full quarter system and was very strongly encouraged to study abroad. So I actually spent two 90-term terms in Berlin, which was awesome. I would not have been a German major without that. And I also spent a lot of time, so as I mentioned, I said that I just got really interested in British politics. And so I found an internship, and then I also found kind of matching funding from a center that was on campus called the Davy Center. I get the feeling that UT has like a ton of those opportunities. I don't know enough, not having been an undergraduate here, how to navigate those. But yeah, you can go through your school, you can find stuff that's like outside of your school. I had one really cheeky friend. He was really smart and went to Yale. He was in high school with me. But his whole family was from Mexico, and he just kind of got tired of the East Coast, I guess. So he spent his whole junior year in Mexico. I don't even really know how it worked, but he, anyway. So sorry, this is maybe like not applicable, but I think that there's ways of doing it. I absolutely recommend it. I'm like not always super good with languages. I spoke German, but if you go into bakeries in Germany and people try to practice their English on you, as opposed to like practice your German with them, But yeah, absolutely. I was very lucky to be able to have that opportunity, and so.
My major, you kind of like have to study abroad.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, it's like required as a graduate.
Okay.
You have to learn the language.
Okay, so they're probably gonna have like resources to help you.
Yeah. But they always ask for like experience or whatever, and like the political sector. I'm like, I'm 19.
Yeah.
I don't know how you want me to go walk into the legislature and be like, I'm.
Yeah, you can get some, but yeah, that is very good. This is also what I found when I was applying for a job. Everyone was like 5 years of experience in a sector. Anyway, I don't know. Eventually get there.
Yeah, and hopefully it's not always just unpaid internships to accumulate that experience. Because that feels like, yeah, for Anne and me, that's what we had to do, was basically do a bunch of unpaid internships so that we could show that we have experience to get paid jobs.
There are paid things as well. So I got apprenticeship and I was like, this is ludicrous. I don't want it. So I had an internship with the Department of Information Resources, which was very boring. I won't tell you about it because you're gonna be friends, whatever the name of it. But that was paid, and when I was working in the legislature, my first year in graduate school, I worked for a committee, and I wound up like accidentally kind of getting paid. It's kind of a long story, but I worked for the Business and Industry Committee, and they paid me, and I was taking, I think, essentially full load at that time. I had like been very creative with the way that I was stacking my credit hours, so I was able to free up a lot of time during the day and make sure that most of my classes ended by about spring break that year, sort of. So that was good. And also, you know, I was a research assistant here, I was a research assistant at the University of Essex. I think those are really pretty nice. Those can be nice things to do, depending on what it is that you're doing. But those are paid.
Okay, so thank you so much to everyone. Thank you so much to Annie for being here. We really appreciate it. And yeah, let's give her a round of applause.